Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Her Silent Spring by Melinda Woodhall. Narrated by Tanya Eby. Chapter 1. The door to the frisky cold diner swung open, and a young woman stepped out onto the dimly lit sidewalk. The clattering of dishes and the smell of stale coffee wafted out into the cool night air behind her as Mac's heart began to race. Sinking lower behind the wheel of his Ford SUV, he kept his eyes on the server's slim figure, watching as she made her way to the battered bike rack by the curb. Despite the absence of a lock, her secondhand bike was still parked just where she'd left it.
One of the many benefits of living in a small town like Sky Lake, everyone feels safe. No crime. No need to fear strangers.
The thought brought a cold smile to Mac's face. The night he'd been anticipating had finally arrived, and little Darla Griggs was blissfully unaware of his presence on the dark street behind her. Starting the Ford's engine, Mac eased away from the curb and circled the block at a leisurely pace. He knew exactly how long it would take for Darla to pedal to the end of Fullerton and turn right onto Hidden Fork Road. From there, it would be a bumpy 20-minute ride out to Old Lady Murphy's boarding house. Mac knew the route by heart. He'd watched Darla every night for the last 2 weeks, and as a hometown boy, he was well acquainted with the lonely roads she traveled each night after her long shift at the busy diner.
I think it's about time someone offered the poor girl a lift.
Turning onto Hidden Fork Road, Mac sat forward in his seat. Overhanging tree branches cast thick shadows on the two lanes ahead, but he could make out a dark figure in the distance.
Looks like she's already found my little surprise.
Darla crouched next to her rickety beach cruiser to examine the back tire. The deftly inserted nail had done its slow but steady job. The Ford's headlights lit up a dogwood tree in full bloom behind Darla, illuminating a cluster of pristine white blossoms that hung heavily on the branches above her head. Glancing back at the approaching vehicle, Darla lifted a small hand to shield her eyes from the glare as Mac brought the SUV to a stop beside her.
Everything okay here?
Darla stood and looked into the SUV's open window with wary eyes. Her mouth softened into a relieved smile when she recognized Mac's concerned face in the vehicle's dark interior. The smile told him she remembered seeing him in the diner, just as he'd expected.
Oh, I'm okay.
She raised her delicate eyebrows in a rueful grimace. Unfortunately, my bike isn't.
Well, it looks like you could use a ride, young lady.
Mac's voice was firm.
Where are you headed?
He arranged his face into a curious frown, as if he didn't already know where she was going. Murphy's boarding house was about 2 miles ahead, just past the turn off to the popular lake that had given the little town its name.
I'm staying at Murphy's just up the road.
She looked again at her tire and shrugged her narrow shoulders.
It's not that far.
Leaving the Ford's engine running, Mac opened the door and jumped down onto the rough asphalt. His pulse quickened as he circled around the back of the SUV and surveyed the deflated tire. He allowed himself one quick look at the face he'd come to know so well, then dropped his gaze back to the bike, worried she would be spooked by the hunger in his eyes.
I know the place,
Mac confirmed, hefting up the bike and carrying it toward the back of the Ford.
I'll drop you off seeing I'm headed in that direction.
Not giving Darla the chance to protest, he loaded the beach cruiser into the rear and climbed back into the driver's seat. Only then did he look over to see that she was still standing in the same spot, her forehead twisted into an uncertain frown.
Come on, he called through the open window. I can't just leave you out here. If anything happened to you, I'd feel responsible.
A rustling in the bushes behind her started Darla's feet moving toward the Ford. She pulled open the door and stood looking into the front seat with wide eyes, then hesitated. Holding his breath, Mac waited in silence. He didn't dare speak, sensing she could turn and flee at any minute, like a deer who'd just heard the crack of a branch under a careless hunter's boot. The moment of uncertainty seemed to pass as quickly as it had come, and with a resolute nod of her head, Darla climbed into the passenger seat and pulled the door shut behind her.
Thanks for the ride.
Her words were accompanied by the shy smile Mac had seen her wear when serving tables at the diner. It was that smile that had drawn his attention. That and her big blue eyes that reminded him of another girl and another dark night near Sky Lake. Mac's foot pressed down on the accelerator before Darla had a chance to buckle her seatbelt, his heart galloping like a racehorse in his chest. He'd waited so long to get her alone, to get her far away from the suffocating atmosphere of the diner. Glancing over at the soft, pale skin of Darla's bare knee, only inches away from his hand on the gear shift, Mac felt lightheaded. He forced his attention back to the road, knowing the detour he was about to take would raise alarm bells, silently rehearsing his excuse. Darla settled her purse on her lap, gripping the cheap leather with both of her small hands, and stared out the window, even though there was nothing to see but the same dark tangle of trees she rode past every night on her way home.
"So, Darla, how long have you been working at the Frisky Colt?" Mac asked, clearing his throat, which was dry and tight with anticipation.
Darla turned to face him. The uncertain frown was back.
"How do you know my name?"
He dropped his eyes to her chest. Her face flushed a pretty pink as she looked down to see the plastic name tag pinned to her brown polyester uniform. She giggled and raised a self-conscious hand to brush back a wayward strand of short, dark hair.
"Well, I guess it is pretty obvious," she said, relaxing back against the seat. "And I've seen you at the diner. You're there a lot, too."
"You like working there?"
he asked, hoping to keep her talking, wanting to draw her attention away from the road.
"Yes, sir," she said with a nod, "and I sure do like the tips."
"Oh, no need to call me, sir."
Mac saw the turnoff to the lake coming up on his left. He took a deep breath and kept talking.
"You can just call me Mac. That's what my daddy always called me."
Mac looked in the rearview mirror to make sure the road was clear.
"It's kind of like a nickname, I guess."
"Well, my daddy never called me anything,"
she muttered, her eyes shifting back to the dark night outside her window.
"Never met the man, actually."
Turning the Ford onto Sky Lake Trail, Mac cleared his throat, sensing her stiffen next to him.
"Just gotta make a quick stop," he murmured before she could ask where they were going. "It'll just take a few minutes. Save me driving back this way later. I'll have you home before you know it."
The lie slipped from his tongue without so much as a stutter. He felt Darla's eyes studying him, but he concentrated on the road ahead. Minutes later, he made another left and began to bump the Ford down a rutted dirt road.
"No matter how far you go, the road always leads back home, doesn't it?"
The Ford crunched to a stop in front of a sagging gate. One of the rusty hinges had come loose, and the wood had split open.
"Where are we?"
Darla's blue eyes widened as she took in the dented sign screwed onto the fence post.
"What Silent Meadows Farm?"
"It's my family's farm,"
Mac said, offended by the disdain he heard in her voice.
"It used to be a grand place before, well, before my daddy had to sell off most of the land."
Thrusting open his door, Mac stepped out onto the rocky road and pushed the gate back. The old hinges issued a high-pitched creak that echoed like a scream through the still night air.
"Glad there's nobody else around here to be bothered by the noise."
Jumping back in the Ford, he ignored the growing tension in Darla's small shoulders as he steered the big vehicle around the side of a dilapidated farmhouse. A waxing crescent moon hung over the gabled roof of the old building. Its frail light enabled Mac to see that more wooden shingles had fallen off since his last visit. The place was falling apart bit by bit, just as his father had. He guided the Ford past the back porch and came to a sudden stop on a scruffy patch of grass. The headlights lit up the long, sloping lawn that stretched out before them.
"Is that a graveyard?"
Darla pointed a small finger toward the black wrought iron fence that ran along the west side of the property. The pale arch of a headstone was clearly visible beyond the fence, as was a weathered sandstone cross, which had tilted precariously on its base. Mac shut off the engine, and a blanket of darkness settled over the yard as he turned to face Darla.
"That's the family cemetery."
He could smell the faint scent of her perfume as he spoke, and he had to swallow hard before he continued.
Lots of old farms have private cemeteries in Kentucky.
He adopted a confident tour guide tone as he tried to calculate how long it would be before she tried to run.
There are more than 13,000 cemeteries in the state. Most of them are privately owned like that one. Come on, I'll show you.
The light from the dashboard revealed an alarmed expression on Darla's pretty face. She shook her head, sinking back against the seat.
No, thanks. I'll just wait here while you get whatever it is you need.
Her voice cracked on the last word.
I've got a blister, so I don't feel like walking around.
Max sighed. A hard edge entered his voice as he stared toward the cemetery.
You know, that's where my daddy ended up.
Even at a distance, he could see the marker that stood guard over his father's grave. As always, the thought of his father sent a jolt of resentment through him. The old man had ruined his life and tarnished the family's legacy.
He was a weak man,
Mac heard himself say.
Too weak.
Clearing his throat, he glanced at Darla's face. He thought he saw pity in her eyes and held her stare, trying to decide if it was time.
What happened? Darla murmured. I mean, how'd he die?
He died of shame, I reckon,
Mac said, his chest tightening at the thought of his father's disgrace.
Dropped dead not long after leaving the state penitentiary over in Eddyville.
Mac thought he saw surprise in her eyes at his admission, and then the pity was back. He didn't like pity. It was a wasted emotion.
I don't look like I come from criminal stock, do I?
Mac's mouth stretched into a sardonic smile.
But looks can be deceiving. Your daddy would have told you that, if you'd ever had one.
Recoiling at the scorn in his voice, Darla dropped her eyes.
I've got to get home, she said, twisting the strap of her purse with nervous fingers. Mrs. Murphy will... She'll be worried.
Of course,
Mac said, although he doubted old Lady Murphy would give little Darla Griggs a second thought. He figured the woman would likely sell the girl's clothes to the secondhand shop to recoup the rent due, and then be done with her. Girls like Darla Griggs came and went without anyone making a fuss.
I'll bet the greedy old bag will have the rooms available sign up in the window again within 48 hours.
Leaning across Darla's legs to open the glove compartment, Mac felt her shrink away from his touch. He kept his voice light as he reached inside and felt his hand settle over the syringe.
Just need to get something out of here so we can get you home.
No need to tell her he meant his home. She'd find out soon enough. It was always easier to let them believe everything was okay until the very last minute. No need to make a fuss, even if there wasn't anyone around to hear it. Mac pulled his hand out and pushed the long needle into the pale flesh of Darla's upper arm in one smooth move. He watched her blue eyes widen with pain and then horror as she looked down to see him holding the syringe.
What are you?
Darla's eyelids drooped and her mouth slackened as the fentanyl began to work its magic. The opioid would put her to sleep with almost immediate effect, and Mac figured she would be out for at least an hour, if not longer. There would be plenty of time for him to finish what he'd waited so impatiently to begin. Slipping out of the driver's seat, Mac circled around to open the passenger side door. Watching him through heavy eyelids, Darla's eyes filled with panic even as they began to close. She opened her mouth to scream, but no sound emerged. Her weak protest faded into a soft moan, and then she was still and quiet.
It's better this way,
Mac muttered, hoisting her over his shoulder and turning toward the house.
Now let's go home.
The first red streaks of dawn fell over the cemetery just as Mac scooped up the last shovelful of loose dirt and dropped it on the ground in front of the headstone. Bending over, he smoothed the rocky soil, trying to erase any evidence that the ground had been disturbed. It had taken a lot of work to excavate the grave beneath his feet, and he was still shaken by the unexpected turn of events. His gritty eyes burned with fatigue as he stared down, barely able to make out the faint inscription engraved on the headstone. It made no difference. He knew the words by heart. Our beloved Susanna. Born 1878, died 1896. Her virtue and grace were still in bloom. Alas, the fair maid found an early tomb. As a child, Mac had always been curious about the young woman who had lived and died in the house a century before. He would stare at the weeping angel on the headstone and wonder what had happened to her. How had she died? Why had she died so young? What would she look like now, after all this time? But an hour before, when he'd stood over the old pine casket, his body coated with dirt and sweat, he hadn't had the strength or the courage to lift the lid and find out. Instead, he'd pulled Darla's limp body down onto the splintered wood and scrambled up and out of the hole, anxious to finish his morbid chore and be gone. Looking down at the finished job, Max sighed in tired relief.
No one will ever suspect she's here, and I'm sure Susanna won't mind.
While Darla's wasn't the first body he'd hidden in the old cemetery, it wasn't something he made a practice of doing. He preferred to bury his secrets far away from the old farm, which had been in his family for generations. He had planned to keep Darla around for a few days. He'd hoped to make a tidy profit, selling her on to a buyer that would pay top dollar for the fresh young woman. Unfortunately, he must have mismeasured the fentanyl. Or maybe mixing it with the oxycodone had made it lethal. Whatever the case, Darla had gone to sleep, and she hadn't woken up. It hadn't taken him long to determine she never would. Carrying his shovel up to the porch, Mac propped it against the rail and stood on the top step, the wood bowing beneath his boots. He took a deep breath and surveyed the property, or at least what was left of it. The sight wasn't impressive. Any of the land that had been rich and usable had been sold off long ago to pay legal bills and taxes, leaving only the dilapidated house and the family's private cemetery for Mac to inherit. The old farm had fallen further into ruin after Mac had moved into town, no longer wanting to be associated with the old place. He'd been unwilling to waste the money he'd been squirreling away to fix it up, but hadn't been able to let the old place go. At least, not yet. Especially now that the little family cemetery contained more than just the bones of his mother, father, and other long-dead and forgotten ancestors. Walking back to the cemetery, Mac took another look around, feeling as if he was leaving something behind. He stepped to a simple marble stone and reached out a big hand to brush the dirt off the name etched across it. He traced the letters with a calloused finger. He had no real memories of his mother, but he sometimes dreamed of the thin, fragile woman he only recognized from the framed pictures still hanging on the walls of the old farmhouse.
If you hadn't died, maybe things would have been different.
Pushing away the useless thought, Mac forced his mind back to the matter at hand. He couldn't let himself fall into one of his dark moods, not unless he wanted to screw up his long history of flying under the radar. He'd broken the golden rule Donnie had taught him, and if he wasn't smart, he might end up paying for it.
Never take a girl from your own town again, Mac. It'll get you caught.
Mac had followed the rule for years, but then Darla had come along. She'd been special, and she'd only been passing through. He was sure no one would blink an eye if she suddenly left town. Most people moved on from Sky Lake eventually. Of course, if someone did raise an alarm, they might be able to track her back to his property. A fresh sheen of sweat broke out on Mac's forehead despite the cool spring breeze, and he headed for the ford, suddenly anxious to get away from the old place. There was always the remote chance that someone would come along and start asking questions. Donnie's deep, rough voice played in his head.
You never know when the feds will show up, so always be ready to run.
Mac climbed back into the ford and started the engine. He drove east toward Sky Lake, heading into the sun. He decided he'd better heed Donnie's warning. He needed to get ready to run. Chapter 2. The persistent buzz of her cell phone on the bedside table brought Veronica Lee up and out of a deep sleep. Eyes still shut, she reached a sleepy hand out and silenced the unwelcome noise, then relaxed back into the soft pillow. She'd almost managed to drift off again when movement at the foot of her bed elicited a resigned sigh. "You aren't going to let me sleep in, are you, Winston?" She didn't have to look down to know that the big orange tabby cat would be staring at her, eager for her to wake up. He had a routine to keep, and he didn't appreciate her disrupting it. Forcing one eye open, she squinted at the bright strips of sunlight shining through the slats of her window blinds. The sun was already high in the sky, and she sat upright with a groan, grabbing her phone and staring at the time with bleary eyes. Veronica groaned again and dropped the phone back on the table, then scooped Winston up into a tired hug. "I'm glad you were here to wake me up," she murmured, carrying him to the bedroom door. "I have an interview in less than an hour." She opened the door and dropped the big cat into the hall. He quickly padded toward the stairs as she turned and crossed to her closet. If she dressed quickly, she'd still have time to get into town in time for the interview she'd scheduled. A new source had come forward with information related to her ongoing series on organized trafficking networks and their victims. Veronica didn't want to miss the opportunity to speak to the young woman and hear her story. She knew how hard it was for trafficking victims to build up the courage to talk, especially to a reporter. And showing up late to their first meeting was unlikely to inspire the woman's trust. Scanning the clothes in her closet, Veronica decided the fresh spring weather called for a change from the dark colors she'd been wearing lately. She pulled on an apple green jacket and matching skirt, then turned to face the mirror. Her long dark hair contrasted nicely with the pale green material, and she suddenly felt a surge of determination. Spring had come. It was a season of renewal and rebirth, and Veronica was hoping that she, too, might get a chance to start fresh. The last year had been incredibly difficult, but maybe it was possible for her to leave the past behind and focus on the future. "And I can start by focusing on getting to Hope House on time." Hurrying down the stairs and into the hall, Veronica followed the aroma of freshly brewed coffee into the kitchen. She had just enough time to fill a thermos and let her mother know she was leaving. Ling Li stood by the sink, gazing out the kitchen window. "Morning, Ma," Veronica said, joining her mother at the window, her eyes drawn to the backyard where a small figure knelt over a bed of flowers. "Skylar's in the garden already? Or did she sleep out there?" Veronica watched the morning sun play off Skylar's silvery blonde hair as the girl worked over the flowers, and her chest filled with sudden gratitude that they'd found each other. "Your sister's definitely a lark." Ling's voice was full of affection as she watched Skylar. "She's not a night owl like you." It was still surreal to hear Ling refer to Skylar as her sister. For 28 years, Veronica had been raised as the only child of a single mother. Then, over the winter, her father had reappeared, intent on revenge, and Veronica had learned who she really was, and that she had a half-sister who needed her help. Accepting that a violent fugitive like Donovan Locke had been her father was hard, and she didn't like to think about all the people he'd hurt during the years he'd spent hiding on his secluded ranch in Montana's Bitterroot Valley. Before her father had shown up in Willow Bay, everything Veronica had known about herself and her family had been a carefully constructed facade, intended to hide her and her mother from her father's wrath. But now that Locke was dead, and Skylar, the daughter he'd hidden away from the world for so long, had been found, Veronica was starting to come to terms with her new reality. Against all odds, they had survived to become a little family, and Veronica wanted to believe that the trauma lay behind them and that now they would all get a chance to heal and move on with their lives. If only she could shake the sense that they were all still in danger and that the evil that had surrounded her father wasn't finished with her and Skylar yet. That feeling made her want to keep Skylar safe and tucked away from anything or anyone else that could harm her. So far, Veronica had only told a few close friends and Skylar's counselor, Dr. Reggie Horn, that Skylar was Locke's daughter and that her mother had been one of his victims. No one else knew that Veronica had a half-sister yet, and she wished she could keep it that way, but she wouldn't be able to hide the fact forever. Eventually, Skylar would be strong enough to stand the scrutiny and the questions. Until then, Veronica was determined to shield her little sister from any more pain. Pushing back the disturbing thoughts, Veronica grabbed her thermos off the counter,
filled it with steaming hot coffee, and added a generous splash of milk. She screwed on the lid as she adjusted her work bag over her shoulder. And now for the latest local news from Willow Bay. The voice coming from behind her was familiar, and Veronica turned to the little television on the kitchen counter with interest. Tenley Frost, Channel 10's new morning anchor, sat behind the news desk. Her shiny auburn hair was perfectly arranged, and her cool blue eyes showed no signs of the traumatic ordeal she'd barely survived only months before. "She certainly bounced back fast," Ling said, nodding at the small screen. "I guess getting fired by Mayor Hadley was a blessing in disguise for Tenley, although I'd have loved to have her on my team." "How is the recruiting going?" Veronica asked, checking her watch. "Will you have a team ready to go in time?" Ling Li had won the heated mayoral election in February by a narrow margin and was scheduled to be sworn in as the new mayor of Willow Bay in less than 3 weeks. As the first woman to be elected to the position, Ling was determined to build a talented team to support her as she took on the new role. But it had proven surprisingly hard to find ideal candidates willing to leave the private sector. "I won't have a media relations officer as talented as Tenley Frost, that's for sure," Ling complained. "I think Mayor Hadley got rid of her just to spite me." Suppressing a smile, Veronica shook her head. "I'm pretty sure Tenley's late-night activities with Garth Bigsby in City Hall played a part as well," Veronica offered, heading toward the door. At the very least, it gave Hadley the perfect excuse to fire them both after he lost the election. Her phone buzzed in her pocket before Ling could respond. Seeing the name on the display, Veronica raised wide eyes to Ling. "It's Deputy Santino," she said, tapping on the speaker icon and holding it out so her mother could hear as well. "Have you found her?" Veronica asked, too anxious to waste time on pleasantries. "Have you found Skylar's mother?"
"That's why I was calling," Santino said.
The U.S. Marshal already sounded tired, even though it wasn't yet 9 o'clock, and she heard frustration in his deep voice.
"We've just gotten back the DNA profiles for the remains found at Locke's Ranch. None of the profiles match Skylar's profile."
His words sent Veronica's heart plummeting.
"I'm sorry. I know it's not what you wanted to hear."
Santino sounded as disappointed as she felt. They both knew it would be hard for Skylar to ever find closure if her mother's body wasn't found and laid to rest. As she disconnected the call, Veronica turned her eyes back to the little window. She'd have to let Skylar know that Santino had called, but that could wait for later. She'd let the girl enjoy the pretty spring day. No need to ruin it for her now. As she climbed into her Jeep and headed into town, Veronica vowed she wouldn't let her sister down. She was an investigative reporter, after all. It was her job to hunt down the truth behind a story, no matter how dark, and bring it to light. "And now my sister needs to know her own story. After everything Skylar's been through, she deserves that much." The drive into downtown Willow Bay seemed to take longer than usual, as Veronica brooded over Deputy Santino's phone call. She needed to find out who Skylar's mother had been and what had happened to her. The question was where and how to get started. Arriving at Hope House with only minutes to spare, she pulled into the parking lot and nosed her big red Jeep into a visitors-only space. The Residential Rehabilitation Center had opened the year before, quickly becoming a haven for women battling addiction, and Veronica had visited the facility several times during her trafficking investigation. She'd been surprised the day before when the facility's director and senior counselor had called to invite her to visit a resident who was nearing the end of her treatment. It was unusual to get a call from a source's doctor, but Veronica had readily agreed when she heard the information the resident wanted to share involved her trafficking series. Pushing through the rehab center's big glass door, Veronica approached the reception desk and smiled. "I'm here to visit Misty Bradshaw," she said to the woman behind the desk. "I'm Veronica Lee. I believe she's expecting me?" "Yes, Dr. Horn told me you'd be coming." The receptionist handed Veronica a visitor's pass. "Misty's already waiting in the rec room. You know the way?" Veronica took the pass and nodded, her thoughts already turning to the woman she was about to meet, already preparing herself to once again witness the devastating toll of addiction. Most of the women she'd interviewed as part of her trafficking investigation had seemed lost and broken. The pain and shame in their eyes had stayed with Veronica long after the interviews were over, and the trust they placed in her by sharing their stories weighed heavily on her shoulders. Yet the possibility that she could save other women from such a fate had kept Veronica working the story, in spite of the danger she faced from exposing ruthless predators and trafficking networks. Inhaling deeply, Veronica braced herself as she neared the rec room. A young woman in a crisp white blouse and knee-length skirt stood by the door. She tucked a file under her arm and smiled as Veronica stepped into the room. "I'm looking for Misty Bradshaw," Veronica said, returning the woman's smile. "The receptionist said she would be in here." Veronica looked around the busy room. Sunlight streamed in through wide windows as women watched the morning news or chatted in small groups. "I'm Misty Bradshaw," the young woman said, sticking out a small hand. "I'm the one who asked Dr. Horn to call you." Trying to hide her surprise, Veronica took the offered hand. "It's nice to meet you, Misty. I'm Veronica Lee, but I guess you already knew that." "Yes, I watch you all the time on Channel 10 News." Misty's shy smile revealed the dimples in her smooth, pale cheeks. "I feel like I already know you, like I can trust you." Looking over her shoulder to make sure no one else was listening into their conversation, Misty lowered her voice. "That's why I wanted to talk to you." Veronica studied Misty's big brown eyes. They were clear and bright, and the woman's hands appeared to be steady as she tucked a shiny strand of light brown hair behind one delicate ear, revealing no signs of withdrawal or distress. "Well, I'm glad you called." Veronica was suddenly anxious to hear the young woman's story. "Let's find a place to sit down." Moving to the courtyard outside the rec room, they sat at a small patio table. The sun was warm overhead, but a gentle breeze kept it comfortable as Veronica took out her notepad. She gestured toward the file Misty was holding. "Is that something you wanted to show me?" The young woman looked confused, then shook her head.
"No, I'm just working on my resume," she explained. "I need to find a job now that I'm going to be getting out of here."
The composed young woman certainly wasn't what Veronica had been expecting. She cocked her head and raised her eyebrows.
"So what is it you wanted to tell me?" Veronica asked.
"Dr. Horn said it had something to do with my trafficking series. Is that true?" Misty nodded. A shadow fell over the young woman's eyes, and she wrapped her arms around herself, her confident demeanor slipping.
"I just didn't know who I could trust."
Her eyes searched the empty courtyard.
"Trust with what?"
Veronica asked, beginning to sense the fear behind the girl's words.
"I have information regarding a trafficker, a predator."
Considering Misty's words, Veronica nodded.
"Okay, but why call me?" she asked.
"Why not go to the police and file a report?" A bead of sweat worked its way down the side of Misty's neck and disappeared behind the crisp white collar of her blouse.
"I heard that a policeman was helping the traffickers caught in Willow Bay a few months back."
Misty's voice faltered and she cleared her throat.
"I'm scared of the police."
"Does your information have something to do with those same traffickers?" Veronica asked, feeling her own heart start to beat a little faster. "Do you have information about the Diablo Syndicate?" Misty hesitated, then nodded.
"I know the police killed Diablo, but there are still people out there who were working for him."
She inhaled deeply, then squared her small shoulders.
"I know who they are, or at least, I know who one of them is, and I know where she lives."
"She?" Veronica couldn't hide her surprise. "The person you believe is working with the Diablo Syndicate is a woman?" A glint of anger brightened Misty's eyes as she spoke.
"Yes, and she's worse than any of the men I had to deal with."
Misty clutched the sleeve of Veronica's jacket as if she feared the reporter would turn away.
"She was the one who pulled me in and got me hooked. Once I saw your report on the news, it dawned on me what she really is. She's a trafficker. And she's still out there."
Looking down at the hand on her arm, Veronica noticed the phrase PS23:4 had been tattooed across Misty's delicate wrist.
"This is what got me through detox," Misty said, catching Veronica's eyes on her wrist. Psalm 23:4 has always been my favorite. You know it?
Veronica nodded, But Misty had already closed her eyes and begun to recite the words in a ragged whisper.
Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me.
Voices sounded in the rec room behind them, and Misty opened her eyes, blinking into the sun as if she'd woken from a dream.
Sorry about that, she said, leaning closer. But it was by the grace of God alone that I was able to get out of that situation alive, and how I managed to get clean.
Staring at Veronica across the table, Misty's eyes filled with tears.
And now that I'm free? Well, I can't just sit by and let that evil woman put anyone else through the hell I've been through.
Questions flooded Veronica's mind, but she knew she needed to take things slowly. Women who had fallen victim to traffickers often suffered from PTSD. Asking them to relive their trauma could trigger unpredictable reactions, and she didn't want to cause the young woman any more pain. As if sensing Veronica's unease, Misty sat back with a deep sigh.
Look, I know I sound crazy, but I'm not. I'm sober and ready to move on with my life, she said. But I can't do that while Amber Sloane is out there looking for me and preying on other women.
Amber Sloane? Veronica wrote the name on her notepad. Is she the woman working with the Diablo Syndicate, or whatever's left of the Syndicate?
Yes,
Misty admitted, absently rubbing a thumb over the tattoo on her wrist.
And I want to tell the police who she is and what she's done. But I'm scared. I mean, what if she really does have a connection there? Or what if they won't believe me?
Wishing she could assure Misty that there was nothing to worry about, Veronica knew that wasn't quite true. The Willow Bay Police Department had a history of police misconduct. And even though Nessa Ainsley had taken over as chief of police and was working to clean up the department, Veronica couldn't be sure that Amber Sloane didn't have a connection with someone inside the WBPD. Well, I believe you. Veronica's voice was firm. And if you want to tell the police what you know, I'll go with you to the station so you can file an official report. She raised a hand to quiet Misty's objection. And I'll make sure you talk to someone you can trust. Sensing the young woman wanted to believe her, Veronica offered a reassuring smile as she continued. And after you've filed a report, you can tell me your story. That is, if you still want to. I may be able to use it in my next report. You can make a difference for other women who may be watching.
Okay, Misty nodded slowly. If you think it's safe, I'll do it.
Chapter 3. The air inside the Willow Bay Police Department felt suffocatingly warm as Chief Nessa Ainsley sat at her desk and tried to ignore the queasy feeling in her stomach. She was now well past the dreaded first trimester of pregnancy, but the morning sickness hadn't gotten the notice. Nausea had become her constant companion as she went about her business, determined to hide any sign of weakness from her team. Pushing away the cup of ginger tea she'd been sipping with a grimace, Nessa brushed a damp red curl off her forehead. She leaned back in her chair and adjusted her jacket. She was still able to fasten the top button, but it was getting harder. She knew from past experience that it would be at least another month before an obvious bump would appear, and she could pull out the old maternity clothes she'd worn during her back-to-back pregnancies with Cole and Cooper. In the meantime, she would have to accept feeling like a stuffed sausage in all of her suits. A buzz from the phone on her desk provided a welcome distraction, and she jabbed at the intercom button.
Chief, you've got visitors up in the lobby.
Frowning at the desk sergeant's words, Nessa looked at the calendar and email inbox displayed on her computer screen, then back at the phone on the desk. I haven't got anything on my calendar, she said, and It's
Veronica Lee from Channel 10, the sergeant interrupted. She says she needs to speak to you about something urgently.
Nessa hesitated, remembering the last time Veronica Lee had shown up unannounced at the station. She wasn't sure she was ready for the kind of trouble that always seemed to follow the young investigative reporter. The sergeant spoke again in a lowered voice.
You want me to tell her you're not in? He asked. Or that you're in a meeting?
No, Nessa sighed, knowing the persistent reporter wasn't likely to give up and go away. I'll be right out. When she stepped into the lobby minutes later, Nessa saw Veronica's familiar figure standing next to a young woman with dark, shoulder-length brown hair and wide, nervous eyes. Veronica!
How are you?
Nessa injected a welcoming tone into her southern drawl. The reporter may bring trouble, but she'd also helped save Nessa's butt on more than one occasion. As Veronica returned her greeting, Nessa thought she saw the reporter's eyes dart down to her midsection for a quick peek. No use in even trying to keep a secret in this town. Tugging her jacket tighter around her, Nessa turned her gaze on Veronica's companion, noting that the woman's hands were balled into tight fists by her side.
This is Misty Bradshaw.
Veronica rested a protective hand on the young woman's arm. Do you have a few minutes to talk? In private? Nessa felt the desk sergeant's curious eyes on her and decided any questions could wait.
Sure, let's talk in the back.
She motioned for them to follow her, but I only have a few minutes. Leading the two women down a narrow hall, she found an empty interview room and waited for them to take a seat around a square wooden table.
Misty needs to file a report, Veronica said without preamble.
Then I'm not the one she should be talking with. Nessa prepared to stand up. I can get an officer in here to—
No, please.
Veronica put out a hand to stop her.
She's seen the news about the connection between the WBPD and the Diablo Syndicate. She's worried the information she has could be shared with certain people who might try to retaliate.
Veronica looked over at Misty, offering a reassuring smile.
I told her it was safe to speak to you, that she can trust you.
An uneasy ache joined the queasiness in Nessa's stomach at the mention of the Diablo Syndicate. She had hoped that taking down the man running the organization would stop the trafficking activity that had been plaguing South Florida for the last year. But recent updates from the FBI Trafficking Task Force had dimmed her hopes. And now this young woman was confirming her worst fears. Factions of the Diablo Syndicate were still out there, and they were now working within a wider network that was still operating in Willow Bay. The detective mentioned in the press is no longer employed with the WBPD. The team I have now is completely trustworthy.
Nessa avoided Veronica's questioning gaze as she spoke. She knew the reporter would want to hear that Mark Ingram was going to be prosecuted for aiding and abetting the traffickers. But the former detective was denying all charges, and with Judge Eldridge presiding over the case, she couldn't be sure yet what would happen. Focusing her attention on Misty, Nessa leaned forward.
Now, Ms. Bradshaw, what is it you want to tell me?
Misty's eyes dropped to her hands, and for a minute Nessa thought she wasn't going to respond. Then she squared her shoulders and looked up, her eyes bright with sudden emotion.
I have information about a trafficker, Misty said in a low, bitter voice. Someone who's been victimizing women in this town for a long time. Someone operating right under your department's nose.
The accusatory tone took Nessa off guard.
Okay, and just how do you know about this trafficker?
I saw everything with my own eyes, Misty said, her cheeks flushing with anger. I was lured in and ended up at Diablo's camp. I was held there and, well, I was one of the lucky ones, I guess. I got away, but not before they got me hooked on Oxy.
Nessa raised her eyebrows. The woman in front of her was clearly upset and angry, but she didn't display any of the telltale signs of an addict.
I've gone through the detox program at Hope House, and I'm trying to get my life back, but I need to know I'm safe.
Misty's voice cracked on the words, and I need to know that she's off the street, that she can't hurt anyone else.
Who's off the street? Nessa asked. Is there another woman in danger from this trafficker?
Misty swallowed hard and nodded.
Every woman in this town's in danger as long as she's out there, Misty said. She's evil, and she'll do anything to protect herself.
Confused, Nessa looked to Veronica, then back to Misty.
Who's evil?
Amber Sloan, Misty whispered. You need to stop Amber Sloan before it's too late.
The door to the briefing room was closed, but Nessa could hear Special Agent Clint Marlowe's deep voice as she stood in the hall. It sounded as if the update meeting on Operation Stolen Angels was already in session. Opening the door and slipping into the room, Nessa motioned for Agent Marlowe to continue, as she sank into an empty seat next to Tucker Van Zinger. She ignored the detective's look of concern and tried to focus on what Marlowe was saying. After the FBI and the WBPD had managed to take out the leaders of the Diablo Syndicate earlier in the year, they were now investigating the wider network of organized criminals trafficking in illegal weapons, illicit drugs, and vulnerable women and children. Feeling Benzinger's persistent stare, Nessa looked over to see the big detective raise his eyebrows and lean forward.
"You okay?"
he whispered, his gaze dropping to her stomach. Rolling her eyes, Nessa nodded. The detectives on her team had started treating her like an invalid ever since her condition had become an open secret. She wasn't sure who'd spilled the beans, but she was dying to find out so she could give them a piece of her mind.
"Is there something you want to share with the rest of us, Chief Ainsley?"
Marlowe's voice was dry.
"Or is it a secret?"
Looking around the room, Nessa saw that all eyes were on her. The federal agents were openly grinning, while her own detectives struggled to keep their expressions neutral. "Okay, fine," Nessa said, raising her hands in surrender. "I'm pregnant. There, I've said it. Now, can everyone just stop staring at me like I've grown another head and get back to work?" A gasp sounded behind Nessa, and she turned to see Detective Peyton Bell staring at her with wide eyes. "You're expecting?" Peyton's face broke into a delighted smile. "That's wonderful. When are you due? Do you know if it's—"
"Not now, Detective," Nessa snapped, feeling another wave of nausea bubble up. "Let's just move on with the meeting."
The room fell quiet for a long beat, and then Nessa spoke again, this time in a calmer tone. "I'm sorry, but we need to focus on more important things right now." She held up a copy of the statement taken from Misty Bradshaw. "I just talked to a young woman, a victim who claims a trafficker with the Diablo Syndicate is still operating in Willow Bay." Holding the paper out to Peyton, Nessa tried not to think about the fear she'd seen in Misty's eyes when the young woman had described the ordeal she'd been through. "The perp is a woman?" Peyton raised her eyebrows as she scanned the report, then handed it to her new partner. Benzinger read through the statement and issued a low whistle.
"Sounds like this Amber Sloan is a real piece of work," he said, shaking his head. "But she might have what we've been looking for."
"And what's that?" Nessa asked, worried by the sudden gleam in the brawny detective's eyes. Benzinger held up the report.
"It says here that Amber Sloan had been working for Diablo, but now she's starting to work directly with his key suppliers and buyers. If that's true, then she may be our way in."
Plucking the report out of Benzinger's hand, Marlowe read through it himself, then dropped it on the table in front of Nessa.
"We'd have to get this woman to talk," Marlowe said. "And based on this statement, I'd say she's unlikely to be cooperative." "You never know until you try,"
Benzinger shot back with a grin. Peyton picked up the report and turned to Nessa.
"Let me and Benzinger take this one," she said, sounding eager. "I have a good feeling about this."
Chapter 4. Peyton sat next to Benzinger in the black Dodge Charger as he drove north on Channel Drive. Nessa hadn't handed them the case until they'd both sworn not to disclose Misty Bradshaw's identity or the details of her complaint once they managed to find and question Amber Sloan. The police chief had stressed Misty's fear of incurring Amber's wrath, and based on the details she'd been given, Peyton couldn't blame her. Amber Sloan sounded like an extremely dangerous person to cross.
"Turn left on Huntington," Peyton instructed, checking the map displayed on the laptop mounted between them.
Suddenly worried her new partner might take offense at her barking commands, she looked over at Benzinger with a grimace.
"Let me know if I'm getting too bossy," she said, studying his profile.
"I can get a little intense sometimes." Benzinger shrugged his big shoulders and laughed.
"If you think that's going to bug me, you must not have met my wife," he teased. "She wrote the book on intense."
It was the first time Peyton had heard Benzinger refer to State Prosecutor Riley Odell as his wife, and she detected more than a hint of pride in his voice. Her new partner had only been married a few months, and from the love-struck look on his face, Peyton decided that Benzinger and Riley were still in the honeymoon phase of their marriage. "We're looking for Fox Hollow Apartments," she said, her tone once again all business. "Should be just past Citrus Drive." Pointing toward a modest, two-story complex on the right side of the road, Peyton checked her notes again. "Amber Sloan lives in Unit 124, she said,
As Benzinger turned into the lot, "Let's circle around the back."
"There it is."
Benzinger nodded toward a corner unit on the ground floor.
"You know what car she drives?"
He continued past the apartment and backed the Charger into an empty space with a good view of Unit 124. Peyton tapped on the laptop's keyboard, then nodded. "She's got a 2016 Toyota Camry, white with..." Peyton trailed off when she saw the door to Unit 124 swing open. A thin woman emerged, carrying a bulky backpack that appeared to weigh more than she did. The woman walked in their direction, then stopped beside a white sedan and opened the trunk.
"I'd say that's her,"
Benzinger muttered. He gestured toward the photo displayed on the laptop screen. Amber Sloan's driver's license showed a young woman with frizzy bangs falling over dark eyes. "Looks like she's getting ready to make a delivery," Peyton said, feeling her pulse jump.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.